So in this last series of lectures in the course, we will start looking at robustness in biological systems, robustness versus evolvability, and a bunch of advanced topics, including a brief introduction to synthetic biology. So in today's video, I will give you a brief overview of what the concept of robustness in biological systems and how it's a very unique property of biological systems. So welcome back. Let's look at robustness in biological systems. It's a very important and essentially an unusual property if you look at engineering systems. Engineering systems are not generally very robust, but you can obviously, we design them to be robust. I mean, otherwise we wouldn't have aircrafts flying us from one place to another. So what are the key concepts? So robustness, one must remember, is not an absolute property, right? So you would say, for example, that the human body is robust to several things. So one of the things you can really talk about is our body temperature is robust. But robustness means there is a range, right? It's not to say that your body temperature is going to be like 37.000 degrees Celsius, right? Your body temperature is going to go slightly up, slightly down. It's never going to go to like 60 degrees. It's never going to go to 20 degrees as long as you're alive, right? So there is a particular zone in which there is this variation. And if you don't wear enough sufficient protective clothing and you're out in the Antarctic in minus, your body temperature is not going to hold, right? So there is a particular, so if you want to have an operational definition of robustness, you need to specify what is the characteristic or function that is robust, let's say in this case body temperature, or in essence what is the zone in which it remains robust, and what is the level of perturbation. If outside temperature changes by 15 degrees, my body temperature is not going to change. I have enough metabolic machinery to counteract that. If the outside temperature increases by 15 degrees, there is no problem. I will sweat enough to keep the body temperature as constant as possible, right. So robustness is a property that allows a system to maintain its function despite external and also internal perturbations, right. And systems that face, that are robust, they also face some fragility and performance setback as an inherent trade-off. So no system is ever absolutely robust to all kinds of perturbations and so on, right? Because the one thing you want is you want it to be robust to the kind of perturbations it will experience, right? So if you are designing a rocket shuttle, you want it to be resistant to certain kinds of temperatures. If you are designing a train, it is going to be robust to a very different set of temperatures and so on, right? So any system is going to be designed for certain kinds of perturbations and so on. And in biology, nothing is really designed but is literally shaped through evolution, right? And that again is going to depend on the kind of stresses that it has been exposed to and so on. And there are some really fascinating studies which tells you how robustness or modularity can emerge as a result of alternating stresses and so on and so forth. And you can have many examples of robustness in biological systems. Can we have a few examples? Talk about body temperature or something, but something little more microscopic. So adaptation is sort of a result of robustness is a consequence of adaptation. So you see that organisms invariably adapt, right? You take an organism from one situation and put it into another situation, it's going to very well adapt. It's going to reach a new steady state, which is and it's quite stable, right? It responds. So you suddenly take an organism from one concentration of nutrient and put it to another concentration of nutrient, it will slowly adapt to that concentration. You suddenly put a lot of salt, give a salt stress, it will react to it, but it will readapt, recalibrate, right? So there is always this very interesting process of adjustment that happens in, there is obviously a lot of orchestration of different kinds of networks that goes on behind this, but the end effect is robustness, right? So there are some properties and some clear cut stability that the system demonstrates in the face of certain major perturbations. And what are the underlying features for this robustness to happen? So for example, in this picture, it shows you how there is a return to a particular attractor, right? You can pull the system out in this direction, but it invariably gets sucked back into the system, which is again a mark of robustness. So this pulling out is the perturbation you are engineering, and this coming back is the system's inherent nature, based on whatever network it is endowed with and so on, to return to a particular thing. Or in certain cases, it might return another gravitational field, another attractor, right. So, you can think of these as multiple stable points, steady states, right, and the system can get sucked into this or it can go into completely something else. Sometimes it can go unstable, right. So, this is when you, you know, do not protect yourself and you, you know, stay out in the cold for too long, right. It can, you know, what happens after a period of time, right. If you are out for like, you know, 12 hours in minus 15 degrees Celsius, you are going to get a frostbite and whatever and so on, right. It is going to be an unstable response. Your homeostasis is just ceases to exist thereafter. So, what are the mechanisms underlying robustness? And you might be able to think of a few, right, from your understanding of engineering systems and so on. So, can you think of certain concepts that underlie robustness? Let us see how many of them work out in biology. What are the underlying principles for robustness? Fair enough. So, robustness and sensitivity are sort of intertwined, I agree. But what are the mechanisms that afford robustness? So, fair enough, that would be redundancy, right. So, in fact, there is a very nice review by Hiroaki Kitano, which I have sort of based this lecture on, and I will share that paper on the class website as well. So, it always gives the example of airplanes, right. Airplanes are really robust, right. They got to be because they survive very testing conditions, and you have redundancy in airplanes. You have multiple, you know that all airplanes have multiple engines, right. So, that is the, you know, central first aspect of redundancy. Not just engines, you have different onboard computers also have, you know, there is some redundancy built in, and you need redundancy in different levels, right. And that is where biology becomes very interesting. So, redundancy I would like to classify it as maybe naive redundancy, which is basically having one more copy, right. You have, instead of one person, you have two people to do the same job. So, if one person does not turn up, the second person takes care of the job. So, if one engine fails, the second engine kicks in. So, this is like what you would, in biology this would be something like isozymes. You have two enzymes that can do the same reaction essentially. You also have distributed redundancy, where you find that there are two, you know, this is I do not think this is ever observed in engineering systems, because engineering systems are designed you know, in a very bottom up fashion, right. So, you know what to put together, and you usually do not have emergent properties in engineered systems. You actually do not want emergent properties, right. You do not want something unpredictable coming out when you put A and B together, you just want them to work as, you know, you would expect, not something completely new happening, right. Whereas, in biological systems, you have this sort of distributed redundancy, wherein you have two completely different pathways which can end up compensating for one another. So, it is not, you cannot narrow it down to A compensates for B, and that is something we even see when we study synthetic lethals and so on. So, I really like the idea of synthetic lethals, because it gives you a good peek into how redundancy has emerged in biological systems, right. So, you could have this could be a synthetic lethal, right. So, let us say this is some A and this is some B, and these are two enzymes. But invariably, you do not see something as simple as this, but you see something and so on, right. So, there is a layers of redundancy that are built in, and finally, you know, you will, there is still the same compensation, but it is just far more robust, right. And you cannot easily break the system down. You can just cannot say, you know, delete this and delete this, the system will die. There is some more, you know, complexity to it and so on. There are like more layers. It's a lot more complex than just having, say, just plain isozymes and so on. So, this kind of very interesting behaviors are observed in biological systems. So, very good. Redundancy is one important concept. What else? So, that would be some sort of, you know, degeneracy, right. And I would probably try to pull that against under redundancy in some sense, right? Or you know, it's more of an observation. It's not a direct principle, right? So this very much happens, right? You always find that low k1 high k2 will give a similar behavior to high k1 low k2 perhaps, right? And this is you know, this is sort of the distributed redundancy that we are talking about. Or this is what we would call distributed redundancy or even distributed robustness, right. So then you always find modules in biological systems, right. So there is modularity decoupling, you also have compartmentalization, right. You have some very interesting concepts such as these which pervade across biological levels, right. So modularity is having or decoupling, and you can also say in some sense insulation, right. You want certain perturbations to be restricted to certain zones. You do not want everything to, you know, respond to the same thing. Right. So, you have certain modules which will, so all these are sort of interconnected, you cannot, it is literally difficult to decouple all of these, right. So, you have redundancy, modularity, decoupling, and they are all essentially intertwined, right. There are so many such fundamental concepts that underlie robustness, right, and we will see how each of these come out as important for achieving robustness. Any other concepts you can think of? You can even think of that as redundancy. Right. So, your lactose utilization system is a backup to your glucose utilization system. Well, it needs to exist in the first place and it needs to be able to switch, and you can think of many other concepts that will come in here as well. Right. So, if something has to be, so the many of these would be bistable systems. So, they will be stable in one state or they will get kicked into another state where they will again be stable. Right. So, and this arises via positive feedback and so on and so forth. So, all these become underlying concepts for robustness. So, you need to have feedback, right, and that could be either, and the other thing to really worry about is, this is not exactly a, you know, a robustness principle as such. What are the trade-offs? Well, evolvability is another very important point, we will kind of get to that. So, this almost sounds counter, right. Robustness is resistance to change, evolvability is ability to change, and they go hand in hand in biological systems. We will see how that happens, right. That is going to be the topic for the next couple of classes, right. But the thing to understand is, there is a lot of trade offs you need to worry about, right. So, even if you are going to design a synthetic circuit, right, we are going to talk about synthetic biology as well. So, you have to design a synthetic circuit, you have to be careful about how you set it up. Right, it has to be somewhat tunable, somewhat robust, but then if you want it to be like super robust, you may have to expend a lot of energy, right, nothing is going to happen without ATP. And so, you have a budget for robustness, right, and that becomes very interesting. So, this is what usually manifests as HOT or highly optimized tolerance. So, sort of a common aspect found in several engineering systems and so on. A nice concept which talks about how robust systems are also inherently fragile. They are robust on certain axes, but they are fragile on other axes. In today's video, we had an overview of the concepts of robustness in biological systems, and in the next few videos, we will start looking at the mechanisms underlying robustness and so on. In the very next video, we will look at the key mechanisms underlying robustness, namely system control, redundancy, modularity and decoupling, and what kind of hierarchies and protocols are used in biological systems, which all contribute to robustness in different ways.